Jenna woke up, and as she opened her eyes, she saw nothing. Her world had become completely dark. She took her hand and she waved it in front of her face, and she couldn't see her hand. She started to look around, and she couldn't see the wall. She couldn't see her toys. She couldn't see anything. She started to touch her face, and she could feel. She could smell. But she couldn't see a thing. There was no difference between the moment she closed her eyes and she opened her eyes. It was complete darkness. In the middle of the darkness, it overwhelmed her to the point of tears, to the point of fear, not knowing what had happened. An hour later, the blackout that happened in the community stopped and the lights came on. And she realized that she wasn't really blind. It was just a blackout. But from that point forward, she was afraid of the dark. Because darkness is scary, is it not? How many of you at one point in your life was afraid of the dark? Many of you. Afraid of the dark. I think the time that I was most afraid of the dark was when, after the first time I ever watched Jurassic Park. I went to bed and all the shadows looked like raptors and T-Rexes coming to eat me. Darkness is a fearful thing. And so today I want to talk about this darkness. Turn with me to James chapter 1. James chapter 1. All of us in our lives at one point or the other experience moments of darkness. And I'm not talking about darkness as in the light goes out. I'm talking about dark moments in your life where you don't see the light, you don't see the hope, you don't see the point of life. Everything just seems so dark and dim. We all go through dark moments, hard moments. And in James chapter 1, verse 2, it says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials." What? Count it all joy. Be happy. Be happy. In fact, go beyond happiness. Become joyful. When you fall into trials, be joyful in the midst of darkness. It's not natural. That little girl, when she woke up in the middle of the night, in the middle of a blackout, and realized that she couldn't see, when she thought she was blind, the first thing she didn't say was, "Ooh, I'm so happy." She was afraid. Darkness is scary, but yet the Bible says, count it all joy. Count it pure joy. When you go into these moments, perhaps the darkest moment for me in college, I was going to Andrews University, and I was not happy about it. I had just done 4 years of undergraduate school. I was hoping to start working, and then I was told that they wanted me to go and do 3 more years doing my master's. I had the major senioritis, and they wanted me to extend my senioritis for 3 more years, and so I just couldn't take it. I really had a problem with this school, and Andrews University is so different compared to Atlantic Union College, where I went to school. I loved Atlantic Union College. It was such a nice, family-friendly, small, intimate school. And then I went to Andrews, and I was just like, oh, this place is so cliquey. I just didn't like it. My only way of escape from the nuisance of this school was my car. I can drive away from campus, the middle of the boondocks, get away from it, go to the local cities, do things over there. In fact, I got a job in a church in a whole other state. That's how far I wanted to get away from there. So every weekend, I would drive an hour and a half to the churches that I worked over there, just trying to get away from that place. My car made it possible to escape from this annoying place. And one day I was coming back to school, I just went to Walmart, bought some stuff on my way back. And as I was driving in one of those cornfield roads, in front of me was a vehicle, in front of that vehicle was a truck. And this truck was puffing out all this white smoke. And I was like, wow, that's a lot of smoke. This guy is pretty dangerous. And he kept puffing this smoke, and eventually one huge puff came out of the truck and completely engulfed everywhere around me, completely engulfed my car. And all I can see in the middle of my car was a blanket of white all around me. I couldn't see a thing. And I knew there was a vehicle in front of me, and so I knew I had to slow down, but I didn't want to slam on the brakes, because if I slammed on the brakes, what would happen would be the car behind me would crash into me. So I was like, let me try to guesstimate how slow I should drive so I don't hit the car in front of me, but not too slow that the car behind me doesn't hit me. And all that is running through my head in the split second that my car is completely engulfed in this white smoke, and I slow down. And then, boom, I hit the car in front of me. It was the weirdest, loudest crash I ever heard. I don't know how long passed, but eventually I got up. And when I came to my senses, the smoke had dissipated, and it was replaced with this white mist that was inside my car. I looked around my car, I saw everything was trashed about. I lifted my head from the airbag, cranked open the side of my door, and came out stumbling. And everybody around me that saw what had happened told me, get back in the car, get back in the car, don't stand up. So I got back in the car, and I'm like, what on earth just happened? What happened to my car? Cora, what happened to you? That's what I called her. She was a Toyota Corolla, so I called her Cora. Cora, no. They rushed me to the hospital. Fortunately, I was okay, but I had tremendous pain in my back. And this was during the summer session, because I knew I had to spend 3 years doing my master's. I really did not want to spend 3 years. So I said, you know what? Instead of doing 3 years of torture with breaks in between, let me do 2.5 years of torture with no breaks. So I'll do the summer breaks. So I did. I was in the middle of the summer classes, and you know how intense it is. And with the pain in my back, And I remember the first day after the accident, I tried to walk. I don't live on campus, so I had to walk to campus, walk to my class, and with every step, I'm like, no, my car is gone. My way of escape is gone. I had to call the churches I was working with. I said, I can't come anymore for the rest of the summer because I don't have any way to get there. I couldn't go to the city. I couldn't go to my churches. I had no way of release. And eventually I said, you know what? I can't do these classes right now. I just need a rest. And so I dropped the classes for that summer break. And for the rest of that summer, I just laid in bed trying to let my back recover, just popping the painkillers, hoping to get better. And there in my bed, I'm like, God, I didn't want to come to this school. This is a bad situation. And it just went from bad to worse. Have you ever had a moment like that? You thought that this is the worst it's going to get. It's not going to get worse than this. And then something happens that makes it even worse. I wasn't really at that moment, like that verse says, I wasn't counting it joy. I should have counted it joy. I should have said, God, thank you that I survived. Thank you I didn't break anything. But I just couldn't get past the darkness. It was consuming me. I was just upset. I was just down. We're going to come back to this passage. We're going to get back to this passage. I want us to take a look at Acts, the book of Acts. So keep a finger here in James, but look at Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5, go down to the end of the chapter. I'll give you a little context here. What some of the disciples were preaching, people didn't like it. And so they took them and threw them into prison. An angel came and released them from prison. The people of the synagogue were even more upset, and they gave them a good talking to, telling them they need to stop preaching Jesus. You know all the persecution that the disciples and the apostles went through during the book of Acts. It wasn't a cakewalk. But yet in Acts chapter 5, verse 41, it says, so they departed from the presence of the council, rejoicing? Rejoicing that they were accounted worthy to suffer shame for his name. What? They had just gone through persecution. They had been just put into prison. They were just threatened to lose their lives. Later on, they are whipped. Many of them are actually killed. But yet, through it all, we have this verse in the book of Acts that says that in the midst of their darkness, they rejoiced. Why? Because they were worthy to suffer. That's what they were rejoicing for. Sometimes people say, you know what? When you rejoice, look at the positive things. When you go through a hard time, look at the positive things that are happening. Well, at least you didn't die, Wayne, in that car accident. That's not what the Bible is saying. The Bible didn't say rejoice for the positive things and the negative things. It's saying that they rejoiced because they were so happy that they were worthy to suffer for God. They were happy for the suffering. Does that make sense? They loved God so much. They wanted to serve God so much that if that meant that they were going to suffer for God, then they're rejoicing. It's weird. It's weird. Darkness isn't natural. You know that they say that if you are in darkness long enough, and they know this from people who've been trapped in like caves or mines, if you're in darkness long enough, you start to go insane. So the natural response to dark moments is to lose it. To freak out. But yet the Bible points us again and again that people rejoice and are happy and are joyful in the midst of darkness. Go back to James. Let's find out why James says to count it all joy, or count it pure joy, as the NIV says. James chapter 1 verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. I remember the first time I read this verse, I was in high school, and I was like, you know what? I'm going to try this out. I'm going to be joyful whenever a problem happens. I'm going to thank God whenever a problem happens. Let's continue reading. I'll explain a little bit more about what happened to me. Verse 3, it says the reason why. The reason why you count it joy when you fall into various trials. It says, knowing that the testing of your faith works patience, or produces patience. What is faith? Faith, as we talked about many times before, is trusting in God. So the trying, the testing of your trust, the testing of this trust in God produces patience. How does that make sense? How does the testing of your trust produce patience? Because if you trust someone and things don't necessarily work out too good, it's harder now to trust them. It's testing their trust. And if it's harder now to trust them, and now you have to wait longer for the result that you're hoping for, or maybe the result that you're hoping for doesn't even come about, you're going to need a whole lot of patience. A lot of times when people pray, they don't pray with patience, because we live in a society that wants everything immediately. Of course I want Amazon Prime, 2-day shipping. In fact, Amazon is actually thinking right now, if you pay, I guess, some huge shipping price, they have drones. They have drones now that are going to be specific Amazon drones that when you want the same day delivery, this drone will drop off, I guess a parachute or something, your package. People want things delivered right away. And so when we pray to God, we want things to be answered immediately. We say, God, I'm going through a hard time right now. I just lost my job. God, I need a new job right away. 1 week passes by, you don't have that job. Another week passes by, you don't have that job. And you're thinking in your mind, maybe I don't have enough faith. But you see, that's the complete opposite of faith. A good situation of faith is going to test your patience. And then when we're going through the dark moments in life and things get darker, things get worse, we start to question God. Why, God? Why? What did I do that was wrong? Sometimes we start to blame God. God, my marriage is struggling, and yet you're not coming through. Perhaps this is a moment, like James is saying, a moment where your faith is being tested. In King James, it says temptation. The word temptation and trials sometimes is interchangeable. Keep in mind, this is a side note, that the Bible also says that God does not put us through temptation, or God does not put us through trials. Sometimes we say, well, God, why are you doing this to me? It's not that God is trying to put you through a trial, but God sees this trial as an opportunity to learn, as an opportunity to grow. And so let's go back to James. Verse 2, let's start from the beginning of verse 2. My brethren, count it all joy, be happy, rejoice when you fall into various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith, the testing of your trust in God, produces patience. At the end of this horrible situation, you're going to trust God more. You're going to become a more patient person. But let patience have its perfect work. Let it run its course, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. In some versions, it says that you will become more mature. This situation, although God didn't plan for the darkness to encompass you, although God didn't plan for that member of your family to get sick, although God didn't plan for you to fail that class, God is using this opportunity to bring something good, for you to grow, to become more patient, so that it can do a complete and perfect work within you, that you can be perfect and not lacking in anything. All of us have gaps in our character. We all have room to grow in our character. Amen. And situations in our life can help us to be perfect, as it says, not lacking anything. So that brings up the question, in the middle of a hard time, can we really go and say thank you? Well, I decided to try it out. In high school, I read this passage for the very first time. And I thought to myself, you know what? I'm going to try it out. And so that day turned out to be a horrible day in high school. I was late, missed my bus, my family got upset with me for missing the bus. Traveling, it got even worse. There was traffic, so family got even more upset. Got to school, it just was one of those days, you know? And every time something bad happened, I remembered this verse. And I said, Wayne, you gotta count it all joy because it's working your patience. So every time something bad happened, I missed the bus. Thanks, God. Got into traffic, getting late for school. Thanks, God. But slowly, my outlook on the day got more and more positive. It almost became humorous that bad things kept coming. And I was like, you know what, devil, bring it on. Bring on more stuff. I'm gonna just have more to praise God about. And I kept thanking God. Thank you, God, for that. Thank you, God, for that. Ah, thank you so much for that. I was getting more and more positive throughout the day. Not always I remember this verse. Sometimes rough things happen, stressful things happen. And sometimes, you know, it gets to you. But sometimes I remember this verse and I say to myself, I got to look at this in the positive way. I gotta thank God that this negative moment is gonna work to my advantage. Because the Bible says that all things wasn't planned by God. All things, however, work together for good for those who love God. God is gonna work it out. And part of the way he works it out is that he uses it as an opportunity for you to grow. But how? How can we get to that point where we can smile in the midst of darkness? We can rejoice when we're hurt. Look at 1 Peter. 1 Peter, just the next book. 1 Peter chapter 5. 1 Peter chapter 5. Verse 7 says, cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Cast all your cares upon him, for he cares for you. Another part of the Bible mentions that his yoke is easy and his burden is light. So combining these two passages, put your burden on him, but yet carry his yoke. You're making a trade with God. God, my burden is so heavy, I can't take it. This hardship I'm going through right now is unbearable. If I stay in this darkness, I'm gonna go insane. Cast that burden upon God. And then he goes around and says, now take upon me, on you, my yoke. Because my yoke is easy and my burden is light. It's not heavy. It's easy. The problem is that we're trying to carry our own personal burden, our own personal yoke, instead of the yoke of God. What is the yoke of God? What is it? We're trying to carry our own burden when God is already carrying it with just his pinky. He can handle it. The yoke of God is the life of a Christian. And the life of a Christian revolves all around grace through faith. Faith being trust. We are saved by grace. We're saved because God does us a favor and has made available to us through faith, through trust. Because we trust God, we allow him to save us. Because we trust God, we allow him to handle our burdens. We're trusting God. That is light. That is easy. And so if you're struggling right now in the middle of darkness, and it's getting very hard for you to handle it, stop thinking that you're strong. Because the Bible says when you're weak, then you're strong. Why? Because God is strong. So if you're struggling with something, maybe you broke up with your boyfriend or your girlfriend, or maybe they dumped you. Maybe you didn't get into the college that you wanted to. No matter what the darkness you're going through, just know that you can make a trade of burdens with God. Give him your burdens and he'll give you his light burden. Jesus doesn't tell us to do anything that he has not already done. And so I want to look at Jesus as the ultimate example. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4, verse 35. Jesus had finished speaking as he normally does, spreading the gospel. And in verse 35, on that same day, when evening had come, he said to them, his disciples being, let us cross over to the other side. Now, when they had left the multitude, they took him along in the boat as he was. And other little boats were also with him. I'm assuming that maybe they had a ship and maybe they tied some small rowboats alongside of it. But then look at what happens in verse 37. And a great windstorm arose and the waves beat into the boat so that it was already filled. A storm happened. Darkness fell upon upon the disciples. A hard moment came upon them. Water was starting to fill up the boat, and whenever water gets into the boat, that is bad news for the sailors. But it was in the middle of this darkness, it was in the middle of this storm, that we read something really interesting about Jesus. Verse 38, but Jesus was in the stern, asleep on a pillow. Jesus, in the middle of a storm, is asleep. Some people come and visit New York and they say, I don't know how you can sleep here. When the train passes by, I can't stay asleep. Imagine if people can't fall asleep with the sound of a train passing by, how much more with lightning crashing, with water splashing on you. It says that the boat was filled with water. So how can Jesus be sleeping? On a pillow, no less. The pillow must be soaked. But yet Jesus is sleeping there as the water is slashing back and forth and sleeping in the middle of a storm. You know that the disciples were screaming and hollering, telling the other disciples, James, take that bucket and start bailing it out. I can't do it, Peter. They're mad at each other. They're screaming at the top of their lungs. Grab that rope. Come on. Pull those little boats up to the side of the boat. They're losing their minds. And yet Jesus peacefully is asleep. Why? Why? Is it possible that in the middle of your storm that you can be peaceful? Look at what the disciples do. It says, going back to verse 38, but he was in the stern asleep on a pillow, and they awoke him and said to him, Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing? Jesus, are you serious right now? We are about to die. We're having the fight of our life. Why don't you care? Don't you care that we're dying? Sometimes you're in the middle of your trial, the middle of your darkness, and you cry out to Jesus and say, Jesus, you better wake up. Are you asleep right now? Are you not hearing my prayers? My mother is in the hospital. God, don't you know what's happening right now? My son is sick. God, are you asleep or are you just paying attention to somebody else's problems? Don't you care that I am perishing? They were upset. They were confused. What was Jesus doing? How can you sleep in a time like this? How can you not answer us? How can you not help us? Jesus had to get up from his good nap. I don't know about you, but when I'm having a good sleep, I don't want people to wake me up. So no wonder Jesus said what he said when he woke up. Look at what he says, and look at what he does. Verse 39, then he arose and rebuked. He didn't just tell the wind nicely. He was all the anger he probably had, I don't know. He just had to rebuke something. So he rebuked the wind and the waves and said to the sea, peace, be still. Jesus didn't have to say, peace, be still, because Jesus already had peace and was already still. But because the disciples did not have peace, and because the disciples were not still like Jesus, Jesus had to get up from his peace and his stillness and help them out. And so he says, peace, be still to the sea. And the wind ceased, and there was a great calm. And he said to them, are you so fearful? How is it that you have no faith? Why are you afraid? Don't you know that I'm in the boat? Don't you know that I'm in your life? How can you be afraid when you know I'm with you? If you see that I'm relaxed, then you should be relaxed. Now, if you saw that Jesus was afraid and scared, then you better just jump off the boat. But if you see that Jesus is perfectly fine, you know that you can be perfectly fine. He says, how can you be fearful? How is it you have absolutely no faith, no trust? They didn't trust Jesus, and that's why they were losing their minds, trying to save the ship. What they could have done, which would have been very hard, was that when they saw Jesus sleeping, they all could have got pillows and slept right next to him. Right? Peace in the middle of the storm. God's first plan in that situation wasn't to calm the storm. He was already calm in the midst of the storm. Sometimes God chooses to do a miracle, and sometimes he chooses not to. But we go back to that James passage where that trying of your faith works patience. And if you let it have its complete work, if you let this trial do its thing, it will be perfect and it will do a complete work in you. Allow God to do his judgment. Not to do what you want. And maybe you too can have peace just like Jesus in the midst of that storm. Amen. This week I know that we as a church went through a hard time, but I know specifically the Gallen family went through a hard time. But you know something that was so amazing, so powerful? On Wednesday, we had a morning worship, and Mark filmed Lolly before she died. He did an interview with her for 20 minutes. And in those 20 minutes, she spoke and gave a message to her daughter, to her son, to her family, to the church. I know many of you didn't get a chance to see it. I encourage you to go and watch it. And something that was powerful in that middle of that video, there was a level, from my perspective, a level of acceptance of the situation. And a question was asked her, are you afraid? And she said, so relax, no. Amen. And she used, throughout this 20-minute interview, the word peace. And we saw it. She had peace. In the midst of her storm, she was in the eye of the storm. But yet, in the midst of her storm, she had peace. That is the power of having a Savior that's living inside the boat of your heart. And so today, for you, whatever storm you might be going through, whether it's with your family, whether it's with the school, whether it's with your job, whatever storm you're going through, if you have Jesus sleeping inside you, you too can have peace. Let's pray. Lord, to the world, it sounds like foolishness. To the world, it sounds crazy. To be happy, to rejoice, to be joyful in the middle of a trial, in the middle of persecution. But for you, God, that's normal. Because at the end of the day, you are still in control. And you're allowing things to happen, and you're using things that have happened to bring about something even greater in us. I pray, Lord, that something supernatural can happen within us. That supernaturally you can come and make our heart your resting place. So that as you are in us, that we too can get some of that peace. So that we too can rejoice in the middle of our trials and persecution. We thank you, God, that that power is made available to us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Amen.